I'm going to be talking tonight about declaring the end from the beginning, because that's the theme for this conference, right? The Declaring the End from the Beginning conference. Isaiah 46:10 is where we get that from. Declaring the end from the beginning. Why? Well, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 10:11, now all these things happen to them. Who's them? The people in the Torah, right? Unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Several speakers have mentioned this already. I'll just ask the question again. How many of you think we are in the last days or pretty darn close to them? You know, it's a relative term, you know, last days, short time, whatever, you know, it's like a day with the Lord is a thousand years is a day, you know, and you're begging God for something. He says, wait a minute, do the math, right? That could take a little bit. So who knows how much time we have left, but I really believe that there's a reason so many people are turning back to Genesis. I call it the Ephraim Awakening. Other people refer to it by a variety of other names, but the point is people are waking up, realizing their Bible does not start in Matthew, and Galatians is not the only book in their Bible, even though we love Galatians, once you understand it. But they're going back to Genesis and they're working their way forward. So I have two presentations I'm doing this weekend, this one obviously and one tomorrow. It's comprised of 20 parts with 100 slides each. So we better get started here. I'm going to be talking about what some may consider to be theological junk food. Okay, some of you know what I'm talking about there. Yes, there is a ministry that many of us know and appreciate and respect, and I'm one of them. I very much appreciate, love, and respect them, and send people to them all the time. But they did put out a video not too long ago called Theological Junk Food. And I'm going to call that into question, because I'm thinking it's not so much theological junk food, but it very well could be a roadmap to help us understand the times that we're headed into. Two people, thank you. Thank you very much, thank you. They put up slides like this. Theological clickbait, shocking, you know, the shape of the earth, amazing new discovery with a giant skeleton there, the Vatican and the names of God. Now, of course, none of those are my thumbnails, but if you've been following my work, you know I've talked about pretty much all that stuff right there. Then they put up a list. The shape of the earth, the pronunciation of the Tetragrammaton, nuances of the biblical calendar, the Illuminati, aliens, etc. I wonder who they're talking about. Well, there are several things that I'm most criticized for. Among them, the four most criticized are the issue of the shape of the earth, the Nephilim, the topic of Genesis 6, Nimrod, Babel, mythology, and the Antichrist, and conspiracies involving those things, and what I refer to as the Ephraim Awakening. Does everybody know what I'm talking about when I say the Ephraim Awakening? Do I need to explain that? Does anybody not know? Okay, a few people. I'll summarize it like this. You're familiar with the prodigal son story? Well, if you read the story, right, there comes a point where the prodigal son wakes up in the pig pen and he looks around and he's like, what have I gotten myself into? What have I done? And he thinks to himself, I wonder if dad will take me back. And when I read that story, as I was starting to come into what we now consider walking in Torah, I imagined taking a snapshot of that moment when the prodigal son sat there, looked around at his surroundings and said, I wonder if dad will take me back. That moment, the Ephraim Awakening, that's what that story is about, the Northern Kingdom, right? So that's why I call it the Ephraim Awakening. And there's a lot more to that teaching. I've got stuff on that online. You can check out lengthy teachings on that. All of these topics can be found in the book of Genesis. The top three are found within the first 12 chapters of Genesis, and they form the very foundation for the entire narrative of Scripture. So if we have a faulty foundation, the whole thing falls apart, doesn't it? It really does. I mean, Psalms 11:3 says, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? Now, if I may ask this question, how many of you would say you've either found a deeper understanding of the Scriptures or a closer relationship with Yahuwah or both as a result of any of those topics up there? Would you please stand? If you don't mind. I'm actually going to take a picture of this for myself. Actually, I'll do a video here. I'm going to do a little video here to remind me Thank you. I often need to remind myself why I do this. Steve asked me how I'm doing in the bathroom. I'm like, yeah, I'm ready, I guess. What are you talking about? The usual. because that's the way I'm feeling. You know, I'm just being honest with you. There have been many, 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 many times where I just wanted to throw the towel and say I'm done. Forget it. I am not comparing myself to Jeremiah here, but I understand the weeping prophet. He had a message nobody wanted to hear, you know. And then I'd go to the post office thinking, I'm done, I'm not doing this anymore, I'm throwing a towel, and there'd be some dude there, he would see me and say, you can't quit. I'm like, what are you talking about? You can't quit. And he would share some testimony, like this gentleman did a few minutes ago. Shared a testimony. I heard many testimonies last night, and the words thank you are just, they're inadequate to express what I'm truly feeling. So I'm going to treasure that video I just shot a minute ago, because call me crazy, but theological junk food does not create that kind of fruit. It doesn't. You know, John talked about fishermen. We're supposed to be fishers of men, right? And fishermen use different types of bait depending on what type of fish they're going after. So apparently this is some pretty good bait because it's bringing in a whole lot of fish. So I will continue to do what I'm doing so long as the fish are coming in. Thank you. So I'm going to start with the question, are we going to believe what the Bible actually says or not? The things that most influenced my life, first of all, were my parents. I was blessed and privileged to grow up in a Christian family. My dad was a Baptist minister when I was a kid, accepted Christ as my Savior when I was age 7, when they used to actually have to walk the aisle. You remember those days where you actually like had to go out in front of everybody and do your thing? And I remember sitting there and my heart was beating so bad. I had already prayed at home, but you're supposed to make that public profession of faith, right? So, and they always played Just As I Am. Remember that song, Just As I Am? They never played the third verse, right? So my heart's going like crazy, and I'm like, oh, I'm making deals with God. Or I'm like, I'll go if they do the third verse, because I knew they never did the third verse, right? So the song director says, you know, we never do the third verse. Let's do the third. I'm like, no! So I actually have to go forward on the third verse of Just As I Am. But my parents raised me to believe this is my source for truth. They brought me to church every time the doors were opened. We were actively participating. Remember Vacation Bible School? You guys have that? Actively participating in some form of ministry my entire life. So that's my sort of spiritual upbringing right there in a nutshell. And the same year that I accepted Christ as my Savior in 1977, I saw this movie right here, which also radically impacted my young mind and imagination. Star Wars, for those of you who can't see through the podium. And was a space freak. You want to talk about a NASA fanboy? NASA fanboy right here. Jim Irwin came through our little church and he signed a picture of him allegedly on the moon. Said, reach for your dreams, Rob, aim high. Of course, later I find out he's a Freemason who discovered the Genesis rock that happens to refute everything in Genesis, but that's beside the point. So these things had a profound impact on my life. So as I move forward in this presentation, trust me when I say I did not want to embrace this at all. I did not. But I claim the Bible as my source for truth. And how many of you remember this song? The B-I-B-L-E. Finish it. I stand alone. I stand alone on the Word of God. Huh. Uh-oh. All Scripture is profitable. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. You know, I spent a lot of time in Timothy as a young child. You know, I think many people growing up in youth group did probably. We also have in the previous book, 1 Timothy chapter 6, O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust, avoiding profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science, falsely so called, which some professing have erred concerning the faith. Grace be to thee. Amen. Uh-oh. Science falsely so called. How many of you know that one organization alone, NASA, for those of you who can't see it, has led many people away from faith? Because nearly everything they do takes us away from the Word of God. And they're not alone. It's all the other organizations that are just like them. They're just sort of the, you know, the big one. Ken Hovind came through town and did his creation seminar, and he talked about what happens to the average Christian who grew up in the church and then goes to a secular high school, and worse, when he goes to college, how many of them fall away from their faith. Because what science, and I believe science, real science, confirms the Bible. But there's this other kind of science that Paul's referring to that is falsely so-called, that when people believe it, they err concerning the faith. Something we need to be aware of. So when it comes to Scripture, how should we understand it? How should we understand Scripture? Should we take the Bible literally, figuratively, allegorically, or as poetry? Yes. What is yes? Now, I was raised that we should take the Bible literally. Now, like Zach, I do not believe in the Mandela effect. However, I have this weird imagination, this weird, you know, memory of everybody telling me I should take the Bible literally growing up, and now all of a sudden it's all figurative, metaphorical, allegorical poetry. Did this happen? Did anybody else have this same thing happen to them? No, Luke, I am your father. Yeah, everybody's telling me that I should take the Bible literally, but now all of a sudden it's all figurative, it's all allegorical, it's all poetry. I believe Scripture is divinely inspired, thus we have no authority to interpret it in any other way apart from that in which the authors were originally inspired by the Holy Spirit to write it. Scripture interprets itself through internal witnesses. Scripture trumps all contrary ideas of theologians, formerly pagan church fathers, popes, priests, creationists, modern PhDs, and most certainly NASA. So, having said that, how many of you do not believe the Bible describes a flat and closed world cosmology? Would you raise your hand? One person, two. How many? Go ahead, raise your hand. A few. All right, just want you to be honest. There are a few people here who do not believe. That's cool. You know what's interesting about that? Wow, there's less than a dozen that raise their hand in a room of, what, 200 people or something? In 2015, I was at a Torah conference, and they put me on the spot, and I had just started looking into it. I started looking into it in April 2015. I think it was May, the United and Torah Conference in San Diego. First question on the panel. So, Rob, do you still believe the earth is flat? Everybody laughed at me.
Don't be stupid here. Don't be a tool of Satan promoting this garbage. There are the people who are behind it. I think the people who make these videos, like this Rob Skiba or whatever his name is, these people are evil people.
Rob Skiba he's a former male model. So his appearance is everything.
They're just doing this to do the work of Satan, just to make asses out of God's people, make them all look like fools. And he's doing a pretty good job making people look like retards.
The people who are convinced of this, it's like Invasion of the Body Snatchers. They've been overtaken by an alien virus, and there ain't a thing in the world you can talk them out of it with.
These flat earthers are doing the work of Satan.
They're taking the allegorical, poetic language of the Hebrew, because most of the Hebrew scriptures are in poetic or linguistic, literary form, the prophets, the writings, and even some of the Torah. And they're taking this allegorical, figurative language, and they're turning it into scientific statements, which is not rightly dividing the word. It shows a gross lack of understanding of the scriptures. We don't take poetry and turn it into scientific fact.
I have a question for Rob Skiba.
Uh-oh.
So, are you still set on the fact that the Earth is flat?
I got a letter on my blog, a comment, and his name is Bill. It was so well written and so articulate, and it expressed exactly how I feel. And so I want to read what he wrote. The flat earth movement, it seems to be very strong, a very strong heart idol to those who have succumbed to it. It's way more than just an errant understanding of astronomy and the natural world. It involves interpreting selective parts of Scripture to quote-unquote prove a quote-unquote flat earth. And it gets wrapped around the axial of righteously, quote unquote, righteously endeavoring to expose the vast conspiratorial lie of NASA and science, which has satanically been deceiving the world about a flat earth, because their heart delusion asserts if the spherical earth deception, quote unquote deception, was exposed, then people would know Yehovah is real. He would be proved, supposedly proved. So this may be a little convoluted. What Bill is saying here is that the people in the Hebrew Roots movement that are advocating a flat earth are saying that NASA and science know the earth is flat.
No way.
But they are, because of conspiratorial theories, they have been lying to us that the earth is round or spherical as opposed to flat. And they also, I might add, these people don't believe we actually went to the moon. They believe that's all a lie and it's all a hoax. And that if people, what these flat earth proponents are purporting is that if the truth of the earth being flat was made known, more and more people would come to the gospel and come to Yeshua and recognize the truth of the Bible. Yeah, exactly. That's it. That is it. It has nothing to do with the preaching of the cross, repentance of sin, of accepting Yeshua, or any of this stuff. It all has to do with the flat earth. Okay, so that's what he, let me read what it is. The focus of these adherents, these flat earth adherents, shifts away from the way of Yeshua and becomes supplanted with endless witnessing, quote unquote, that the earth is, quote unquote, flat, and that we must awaken those deceived by a ball earth or a spherical earth. They actually think they are in alignment with his will, that's Jehovah's will, by pursuing such a quest. And some, too, pursue sidetracking, itching ear topics like the Nephilim, with emphasis on the Book of Enoch, etc. Even worse, there are some self-appointed leaders of our Hebrew Roots understanding who get impaneled, in other words, they become part of discussion panels at conferences, get impaneled at conferences, who spout off such sidetracking issues and get carried away by them. When others who are considered legitimate leaders of Hebraic roots are informed about this delusion coming upon them and being propagated by fellow quote-unquote teachers, instead of rebuking it, they just evade the matter under the concept of echad, or unity. It's another form, another word for ecumenicalism. Let's all just overlook areas of truth, and let's not break unity over these things. It's a go-along to get-along mentality. We can still fellowship and break bread with one another, even though we have different opinions, as if this were the same kind of difference, quote-unquote, difference of opinions matter as a calendar. It is not, in my opinion. The hyper-conspiracism inflicting the hearts and minds and souls, in other words, it's all a conspiracy. Hyper-conspiratorialism, I think it would be a better choice, inflicting the hearts and minds and souls of growing number of those in the Hebrew Roots movement is alarming. It needs some very bold rebuking by legitimate leaders and teachers who are truly inspired by Elohim and not self-promoting false teachers inciting intrigue about matters such as the flat earth and distorted emphasis on Nephilim, etc. Natan, are you aware of this developing delusion coming over in growing segments of our brothers and sisters? Well, sadly, I am. And I respond, thank you for your post. Yes, I'm aware of these issues and totally agree 1,000% with everything you have said, and have been trying to deal with these issues behind the scenes with people who contact me about the flat earth and hyper-conspiratorial viewpoints. The flat earth, Book of Enoch, and other such subjects are a great distraction to take our eyes off Yeshua and the basic gospel message. I can't emphasize this point enough. These side topics do not bring us into a closer walk with Elohim through Yeshua. Therefore, they are not edifying the body of Yeshua in any way. Rather, they are taking us away from him. They are moving us into the area of Hebrew roots Gnosticism. Gnosticism. It's a form of esoteric belief system that has a form of truth, but it gets people totally away from the message of the cross, just like the Gnosticism that occurred in the first and second century among the early believers. You think Satan has new tricks up his sleeve? He does not. Satan is having a heyday as he spews out his flood of deceptive words. Remember Revelation 12, 15, where it says that Satan the serpent will, a flood that comes out of his mouth to deceive the woman and the remnant of her seed to keep the commandments and have the testimony of Yeshua. This is what I believe this is. This is part of it. And this is a vehicle. It's through the vehicle of the internet's tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The internet is a tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And there's good on there, but there's also evil. And there's so many YouTube videos and so many things where people can get their ears tickled and find anything on any subject, and it gets them away from Messiah. And that's exactly what this flat earth thing and the Nephilim and all of this Book of Enoch, all this stuff is all about. I rebuke it in the name of Yeshua. I rebuke it in the strongest terms, and I rebuke those leaders who, self-promoting leaders, supposedly those false leaders and false teachers who are emphasizing this and teaching it. You are taking people away from Elohim and away from Yeshua. You are not bringing them to him, and you are to be rebuked. And you need to stop preaching a false message, and you need to get back to what the apostles taught. They preached the message of the gospel, Messiah and him crucified. They had a higher level of intelligence than you and me and all of us put together. We have been dumbed down, and now we are feeding from the pig trough of human swill, and you are elevating it up to a level with the message of the gospel. Shame on all of you who are or any of you who are doing this. And those teachers who are teaching this, those of you watching this video, you need to turn away from them and have nothing to do with them, because you cannot trust their judgment. You cannot trust what they're saying. If they're going to follow this delusion over here, then everything else they say, even the good things they say, it is suspect, because they have spiritual blind spots, and they may be actually slipping in false teachings that are damnable heresies into the other things.
And every time you say the Bible teaches that the earth is flat, you are being blasphemous. You are making a mockery of the Word of God, and you need to repent of your stupidity and foolishness and quit making a mockery of the holy, eternal Word of God that is perfect in every way. The Bible's not stupid. You're stupid.
My, how the tables have turned. That's interesting. A lot can happen in a few years. Now those who claim the Bible as a source for truth are in the minority who do not believe that. The Bible describes a circular enclosed world cosmology. But if you do believe the Bible happens to describe a globular earth, heliocentric or geocentric, you do so based primarily on two scriptures, Isaiah 40:22 and Job 26:7. Circle of the earth, and hangs the earth on nothing. See? Globe hanging in space. I used to teach that myself. Problem is, neither one of those scriptures actually work for you at all, and we'll talk about that throughout this presentation. But if you believe, especially in the heliocentric model, that the earth hangs on nothing, you can't use that verse, because in your model, the earth is literally hanging on the gravity of the sun. So that scripture doesn't work for you, and circle does not mean globe. So let's go ahead and jump into this. Now, for those who are not yet on this page, look, mocking is easy. We've all been there. I did it myself. This is crazy. This is stupid. Come on. All right, I'm just going to suggest, please try a little bit harder. There is a principle, which is a bar against all information, which is a proof against all argument, and which cannot fail to keep a man in everlasting ignorance. That principle is condemnation before investigation. There's another quote famous quote along similar lines by Aristotle. It is the mark of an educated mind to be able to entertain a thought without accepting it. So allow yourself just to open up your mind a little bit to consider a few things as we go through this. And King Solomon says that he that answers a matter before he hears it, it is folly and a shame unto him. So allow yourself some time to just consider what is being said here. If you're interested in doing the investigation yourself, I would suggest you start, first of all, with the Bible and the prayer. Father, if I'm bringing preconceived bias to the text, please remove it from me. Let your Holy Spirit teach me what is actually being said here. And I'm going to actually just ask you to pray that right now. I'm not going to lead a prayer. I'm just going to ask you to close your eyes. I am not your teacher. I'm up here. I'm a loudmouth student, okay? I'm an opinionated student. I am not your teacher. The Holy Spirit, 1 John chapter 2 says, let the Holy Spirit be your teacher. All right, so I'm going to ask you right now just to say a quick prayer. Don't listen to what I'm, listen to what I'm saying, but don't take what I'm saying to heart. Let the Holy Spirit be your guide. Ask the Holy Spirit to confirm whether what is being said here is true or not. Okay, that's a dangerous prayer to pray, especially when you bring your own biases to the text. Aside from the Bible, there are some other interesting books that were written in the late 1800s and into the early 1900s. You see there's Zetetic Astronomy by Samuel Robotham, 100 Proofs by William Carpenter, Terra Firma by David Wardlaw Scott, and Kings Dethroned by Gerard Hickson. I've combined, Sheila and I both combined the scripture references with the two books that you see there into one volume that we'll have available here this evening and or tomorrow if you're interested in checking that out. Let's go ahead and dive in. Genesis chapter 1. We're declaring the end from the beginning, right? So let's start in the beginning. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. There's a ministry out there who's produced a video called Is Genesis History? With one exception, I think it's an excellent video. I really do highly recommend it. If you have not seen it, you should check it out. It's very good. But I'm going to play a few clips from that video and make some commentary on it.
I think if we zoom out from that and say, well, what really is the difference between these two paradigms? It isn't a question of science on the one hand versus religion on the other, because both of them are scientific in the sense of looking at a common body of data. Really, at the deepest level, the difference is two competing views of history. What is the true history of our cosmos?
That does seem to be the real question. What is our true history? What actually happened? The conflict is not between two views of science, but between two competing views of history. Since Genesis was written in Hebrew, I wanted to talk to a Hebrew expert. What was actually in the original text?
The first word in Genesis is Breshit. Breshit. Genesis 1:1 is Breshit bara Elohim et hashamayim ve'haaretz. So this is the beginning of the Toledot of Noah. Interesting that word Toledot is a very interesting word. It's translated sometimes genealogy, sometimes it's translated history. And what follows then is the account of the flood.
Mm-hmm. Steve, it seems that there is a lot of history in the Bible. Is that how you see it?
Oh, absolutely. In fact, the first thing is that it's an accurate historical account.
Mm-hmm.
The presentation is such, and the perspective of the writers, that they believe they were talking about real events.
Okay.
It's very obvious that because of the way in which they insist that the next generation learn mm-hmm. their history.
When you look at these early chapters in Genesis, what do you see? Can you take us through this?
It starts with, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. There's no word in Hebrew for universe. That means he created everything.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next thing we find in Genesis 1:2, we find a water ball that is in space.
Mm-hmm.
God, in the subsequent days, is going to fill that universe.
We have a recognized expert saying that Genesis is an accurate historical account. But then he goes and says that what we see here is a water ball floating in space. Let's go back to the scriptures here. Does anybody see a water ball floating in space? So do you see how even experts will impose their own preconceived bias onto the text? We all do it. There's no water ball floating in space in Genesis chapter 1. Let's continue. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. Pretty cool? Everybody good? Cool. Uh-oh. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament, divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. I'm stressing a and the because there's only one. You guys see that? Everybody see that? Okay. Now, first thing I want to address before going into the issue of the firmament is, what is a day? How many of you have heard of the day-age theory? That a day is not really, you know, we talk about a day with the Lord is a thousand years is a day. So they'll take scriptures like that and say, well, when we're looking at the creation account, the days must actually mean long periods of time. That's how they're trying to force an evolutionary mindset onto the scriptures. Well, let's see about that. What do the experts have to say about doing that?
Well, you're talking about days here. Do you see these as literal days? Is that what the text is telling us? Or you know what other people think, that this is just a poetic, different
Well, first of all, it's not poetry. The world's greatest Hebraists all affirm that this is a narrative. Mm-hmm. They say that's one of the unique features of the Genesis accounts of creation and the flood is that they are narratives, because in the ancient Near East, they are done in epic poetry, which is very different. Now, here we have narrative to indicate that this is historical. What that means is that you should understand the words, the normal way in which those Hebrew words are understood. The word yom, it means day. The foundation of its usage is what we mean by a day. It's a 24-hour day. The only way you'd want it to mean a longer period of time is if you impose an alien concept to the text, mm-hmm. and say, well, I think that these are ages, and therefore yom has to mean ages. What you have to do is start with the text.
Yeah.
If we start with the text, yom means day.
So when we come to the passage that talks about the creation of Adam and mm-hmm. Eve, you're seeing that as a clear historical event, which would stand in direct opposition to the conventional paradigm that man evolved out of a long, long process.
The biblical text is not compatible with the standard, the conventional paradigm.
Again, it's a historical narrative. It is not poetry. It is not compatible with the standard conventional paradigm. Now, in this documentary right there, they're, of course, talking about the days before the creation of man. But I think we need to go a little further back to the earlier part of the narrative. You know, they're trying to refute the idea that there were long periods of time within which man evolved, and I applaud them for doing that. But evolution in and of itself is not even remotely plausible without the heliocentric globular earth model upon which that is based. So we need to go back to the scriptures that we're looking at there. And let's talk about the firmament.
Thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video presentation. If you did, please subscribe to my YouTube channel, like the video, and share it on your favorite social media sites. There's a lot more to come, so stay tuned, and we'll see you back next time.